My name is Truman Ardent Smith. That's my pen name. And I'm a former evangelical Christian. I left the faith after being a born-again Christian for 25 years. I became a born-again Christian after college in 1984, and I left in about 2009. In 2007, I got a seminary degree from a seminary called Lutherized Seminary, and one of my professors is now online. His name is Tony Guthrie. He's a seminary professor, and he's the author of a book called Cussing, the Homiletical Bridge. Welcome to the webcast, Tony.
It's good to be here. I appreciate the invitation.
You know, your title has, it's kind of a big word there, homiletical. Do you want to give a short description about what your book is about?
Well, it's just a fancy way. It comes from the Latin word homily. It has to do with preaching. So homiletical is just the process of developing homily or preaching, Christian rhetoric.
Okay, and do you want to say anything else about your background as far as what you do for a living?
Well, I've been at Luther Rice University and Seminary since 2003 after getting a PhD in preaching and Christian rhetoric in 2002 from New Orleans Seminary, and I've been teaching for these last 12 or 13 years. So my specialty or my expertise, obviously, is in the area of preaching and rhetoric, and so I enjoy the discipline.
Okay. So our topic today, we're going to spend about 30 minutes approximately, and we have about three different subtopics, and basically I wrote a booklet here, and this is the booklet, and Tony has some comments, and we broke these down into three categories. I don't know the details of what you're going to speak about, but so in general, we have the first category is about rhetoric and overstatements. These are objections from Tony's viewpoint we're going to discuss. The second item would be regarding biological evolution, and the third item will be on philosophy, subtopic called the problem of evil. So with that, Tony, I'll let you introduce. You read the booklet, and so what are your criticisms about overstatements and rhetoric?
Well, I just remember when you were a student with us back in 2006, 2007, you were actually a favorite topic among the faculty because you seemed to be quite combative. At that time, you were a Christian, and you were obviously very concerned about things that were going on in the church. I guess this was laying the foundation for your eventual deconversion. But I remember a distinct conversation with you once about just how much pastors are paid, and you were very troubled about some of the mega church pastors being paid high sums of money. You really couldn't justify that in your mind. And when I asked you to try to defend that, and what would a justifiable salary be, you really couldn't come up with one that I recall, and I accused you of barking up a tree and having no evidence for what you were barking about. And so it's similar what I see here in this particular document. You know, we're going to talk first of all about rhetoric, and being I'm also the director of the Doctor of Ministry program at the school, and I head up research and writing and teach that course. And at the doctoral level, we demand a lot of evidence and support for statements that we make. And you make a lot of what I call overstatements in this particular treatise that you've written here. Some of them are actually gross overstatements. Grand and complemented with that is grandiose assertion. Even the title of it, Modern Science Destroys Christianity. Well, obviously, this is an overstatement. It doesn't destroy it. It might raise some interesting questions or some challenging discussion topics, but it doesn't destroy it. Your 10-page treatise is not going to wipe out Christianity and the tenets of Christianity. You know, the 5,000-year history of Judeo-Christianity is not going to be wiped out in your assertions about what you think does or does not make up valid evidence. And so that's one aspect of it. You know, I would think that you would say that modern science raises challenging questions or something like that. Another massive overstatement, just from your own writings, these are your words. Everything I wrote is sufficient to show that Christian theology no longer survives in light of modern science. To argue otherwise shows some kind of ignorance in science, either in biological evolution or neurology. Again, this is an overstatement. Everything I wrote is sufficient that to show that Christianity or Christian theology no longer survives. I think that's a little bit extreme. You don't defend that statement. You give very general analysis of what you think the evidence for evolution is, what you think the evidence for neurology is, and things of that nature. But a massive overstatement like that is, again, just not good rhetoric on your part. Let me give you one last example, or another example, and then I'll give you an opportunity to respond. You say, now that we know how the brain functions, there is no homunculus, which is obviously another word for the soul. There is no master controller overlooking everything and making decisions. So what you're doing here is you're making a statement and drawing an assumed conclusion within that statement. But you don't have any scholarly support for the statement. It's just an overstatement. You're just saying, we know how the brain functions, and therefore there is no soul, and therefore there is no God. And there's much more to that dialogue than just that statement. So those are just a few examples of what I would consider the overstatement or grandiose assertion.
Okay, thank you for that. I've done quite a few debates, and one thing I've been learning is that I think it's really good for people to have a dialogue, because a lot of times in debates, people give one, their position, then the other side gives their position, and they don't ever have a dialogue, and so the person watching is like, well, you know, what's the remark on that? So in our discussion, we might want to try to focus in on certain things and not like have a shotgun approach, because then there's too many things to talk about. We're going to run out of time. So okay. I did want to briefly discuss every issue you brought up. One issue you said, when I was in the seminary, there was some faculty discussion about me. That's kind of funny for me, because I had no idea about that, you know, whatsoever. Oh. You know. Then as far as, some of these pastors making too much money, what I did at the time was I made a chart, because I had my own 501c3 Christian preaching ministry, and I wanted to find out what a reasonable salary was. And so I did a chart of all the salaries, and then people like John Hagee stood way out. He had over $1 million salary. And then as far as what's a reasonable salary, well, that's actually pretty easy to answer. I think I even gave you the answer at the time. It's by looking at the chart, it's very easy to see what averages are and where things lie. And so for Hagee, for example, he was just off the charts. It was just crazy. And, you know, and usually it's like the limit is like 150,000 or so. So a million is like, you know, it's almost 10 times that. You know, and you said I have a lot of overstatements. For example, it's kind of funny because, for example, I'll say something like, any kind of overstatement, like science destroys philosophy. It's kind of interesting because you say that's an overstatement, but there's a lot of atheists who read my document, and they're saying, like, well, duh, there's nothing new here. So it's kind of interesting. Everybody I'm going to talk to, I'm going to have a different conversation with, depending on what they want to talk about. When I said everything I wrote is enough to, all the science I wrote is enough to disprove Christian theology, one thing I want to note is that most Christians, evangelical Christians especially, reject evolution. And if they were to accept evolution, I think that would destroy their theology. And that's the reason why I think there's such a animosity towards evolution. And yes, and the booklet, I do acknowledge that there are Christians who fully accept modern science. And this would be an example of Biologos, for example, or Dennis Venema on YouTube, who tries to explain evolution to people. And that's where I go on and say, now let's look at philosophy. And we're going to talk about that in our third one, the problem of evil.
Okay.
And then as far as the brain functioning, yeah, I kind of spaced out on our previous discussion. We should have actually had that as a separate topic, because that alone is by itself is a big thing. But my point there is that with modern neurology, it's from a naturalistic viewpoint, it makes perfectly sense that the mind emerges from the brain. You know, for example, when a baby's conceived, there's no mind because there's no neurons. And then when the baby's born, the neurons are a little bit more, but there's still not much consciousness. And then, you know, we just see this consciousness emerging. And then actually, as they get older, they go into dementia. And if this was all seen naturalistically, it all makes perfectly sense. But to say that there was some kind of spirit given to you as a soul, then there's all these kind of weird problems, like, you know, what happens if you're retarded and you die? Are you going to be retarded in heaven? And or if you're an infant when you die, and all these things about identical twins.
I actually was prepared to talk about that and maybe in the next section, but since you brought it up, I mean, you make that statement in your booklet here about if a child is born retarded, will it be retarded in heaven? If someone is senile and they die, well, they're going to be senile in heaven. Well, the answer to that is, of course not. You're trying to make heaven a fleshly realm, and there's a huge distinction between the earthly realm and the heavenly realm. And obviously, a child who's born in childbirth, I mean, it's not going to be a child forever and eternity in a place called heaven, and certainly someone's not going to be senile. I'm 52. If I were to die tonight, I don't think I would be 52 in the afterlife or in heaven. I think I would be whatever God wanted to make me. This mortal shall put on immortality is what the scripture says, and that back in the garden, if we go back even to the idea of original creation, that perfect, there was no age, there was no dying, supposedly at the original plan of God. Restored in heaven, there is no age, there is no death, there is no pain, there is no suffering. So to equate how we live in this life or how we die in this life to what's going to be like in that life is not even it's not even on the same page of dialogue. So I was really kind of surprised that you actually put it in your document, because you know that any theologian, the first thing they're going to say to you is you can't equate the here and now to the afterlife.
Okay, so maybe we can spend just a couple minutes on this one topic. So in this world, let's consider one thing we can consider is that the natural miscarriage rate is something really high. I'm not sure if you're aware of this, but it's like 75% or so, which there are so many natural miscarriages that a lot of men are miscarrying without even knowing they're pregnant, and it's like 70% or so. Mm-hmm. So, you know, in this life, we understand that if a child was born here in America versus born in anywhere, and even in a different family, they're going to be a different person based on their environment. This is the idea of emergence. So now if this thing miscarried and then died and their soul went to heaven, how could there possibly be any, I mean, how could this thing grow into some kind of mentality?
Well,
I mean, you know, like on Earth, it'd be totally different depending on where they live. So how would that be on heaven?
Well, again, you're equating the here and now to the afterlife, and that there is no comparison between the two. I can't speak to the subject of miscarriage to an overly intelligent degree, because there again, that is not a subject related to what we're talking about in the sense of that soul is actually developing and have an opportunity to live life. That is a subject that I would equate to the ramifications of the fall, that life is now, because the fall of man, the sin of man that entered into the world, and God allowed us to live in the natural realm more than the spiritual realm, there's going to be pain and suffering, and miscarriage is a part of that. But the joy of knowing Christ as Savior, the joy of having eternal life, is the knowledge and the hope that one day we will be free from the bondages of this life and the pains of this life and the sufferings of this life, and that in heaven, where it says in the book of Revelation, there is no longer any death and no longer crying. The former things have passed away. All things have become new. And you can write these things down because they're faithful and true. Jesus said to John, and he was writing those words. So again, you're not equating apples and oranges. You're equating two entirely, or you're equating apples to oranges. You're two entirely different playing fields. There's a huge difference between the here and now and the fleshly realm, and the eternal.
Well, I guess part of the problem is it seems like the word soul is not really defined. I mean, you know, like with the other case too, if somebody's 80 years old and they're suffering dementia, what are they going to be in heaven? And you know, some preacher might say like, well, perfect. it's like when they're in their 30s and they're at the peak of life. But it's like, well, maybe their peak physically.
I don't mean to interrupt you, but this is very simple. In heaven, they will be perfect. It will be completed. That's what heaven is about. It is the completion of the work of Christ.
If
you are living in dementia in this life, you won't be living in dementia, because the former things have passed away. The sin and the wickedness of this world will have been given away, thrown away, cast away, tossed aside for the glory of the eternal with the Lord Jesus. That's what the scripture teaches. That's what Christians believe. That's what their hope is in. This very world is what gives them the hope of a beautiful, perfect future.
Yeah, but I'm not thinking of it from an aspect of perfection or imperfection. I'm thinking of it from an aspect of identity. Like everybody has a different personality. So how would they develop a personality when we're our personality is shaped by our surroundings?
Well, I can agree with that wholeheartedly. I'm the person I am largely because of who raised me and the experiences of my life, where I was educated. I wasn't educated in Peru, so I don't have the mindset of people who live in South America or parts of South America. But it still doesn't have anything to do with whether or not your emergence theory carries any weight into the afterlife. Who I am in the here and now is where God once wanted me to be. He wanted me to be born in Nashville, Tennessee, and be raised up in Tennessee, and then live this portion of my life in the Atlanta metro area teaching at the seminary. I accept that as God's sovereign plan. The fact that I wasn't raised somewhere else, or if I was raised somewhere else and would have been a different person, it's still irrelevant to the point. I still would have been where God wanted me to be, doing what God wanted me to do, and following His plan for my life. It's a pretty simple question to answer.
Well, I guess, you know, just another aspect of the way I'm looking at it is from a matter of personality. When I look at my life, my personality changes. There is no core personality. It changes. And for example, at one time I was an ardent Christian, and now I'm an ardent atheist. There's no way to, it's not like Microsoft Windows where you can go back to a restore point. I'm a different person in time. And so this is, I just don't understand if you had a full life, when you have a soul, what your personality would be like.
Yeah, but now you are contradicting the science of human development. All human development theorists tell us that our foundational personality is developed in the first 4 to 6 years of life. You might express it differently at times in your life, but the person that you basically are is the same throughout your lifetime. Your likes are the same, your interests are pretty much the same. They might alter, they might develop, but your formative years are those first 4 to 6 years of life. This is scientific theory found in every textbook on human development. So you're contradicting the very science that you claim to espouse.
Well, when I was younger and went to high school and college, I was very interested in electronics, and now I don't really have any kind of interest in that, and more of philosophy. So, you know, this is, and of course, when I'm 4 years old, I wouldn't predict any of that because I didn't even know what philosophy was.
Well, again, change in interest is not change in personality. Those are two different things.
Well, it seems like
my life, I was a devout musician, but now I'm a public speaker, preacher, communicator. Both of those are very similar things because they both allow me to use creativity, put me on the stage in front of people, allow me, and you're doing something different with it, just the same aspect of your personality, just used in a different way. It doesn't mean that you are becoming a different person. It certainly doesn't mean that in the afterlife, it has ramifications for that. Whatever you are in the now is just who you are in the here and the now.
I would think that what I do has a huge impact on my personality. Like if I'm working on designing computers versus studying philosophy, I think that has a huge impact on personality.
Okay.
Well, so anyway, so maybe we'll go on to the next one. I mean, we're not going to probably agree on anything, but it's just nice to have a discussion. I appreciate
absolutely.
That.
I'm enjoying it.
Okay, so the second one is... I make the claim that biological evolution is true. It's a fact, and your criticism is?
Well, that you just make that categorical statement that it's true. Everything that you say in the treatise is based on the assumption that it's dogmatically, irrefutably, non-debatably true. And so, therefore, if that foundation can crumble, then the whole treatise crumbles, the whole 10 pages crumbles. There are plenty of erudite, academic, scholarly, PhD, scientists and theologians and philosophers who do not hold to biological evolution for a number of reasons. Now, they tip their hat to the evidence that suggests it, as I do, as people who are intelligent, who are well-thinking, who are well-intentioned, and they're honest with the facts. They can look at the evolutionary hypothesis and say, yeah, there are things that are here that are hard for me to argue with, and there are things that would suggest that the people who hold to that theory are not, they're not ignorant. They're intelligent people looking for the same answers that the rest of us are. But for you to assert that it's dogmatically, irrevocably, irrefutably true, non-debatably true, it is, again, an overstatement and a massive assertion. There are plenty of scientists, theologians, philosophers who say, now wait a minute, there are other things that would suggest otherwise. And so this is what I'm, you know, to, for lack of a better word, attacking in your theist. Your whole argument is based on the assumption that evolutionary is just the evolutionary hypothesis is just true, done deal, non-debatable.
Well, yeah, personally, I do think it's a fact. And, you know, I mentioned in the booklet, an evangelical Christian, Dennis Venema. He's a scientist at a Christian university, and he basically is trying to inform his fellow evangelicals about the evidence for evolution. And just the DNA of it, I find it's so overwhelming that, you know, I think most of this are going to, I mean, I think most viewers who are academics maybe even might even look at this and say, how could we take seminaries even seriously if you can't accept evolution? I mean, in today's modern world, this just seems crazy. Just, I'm trying to be respectful here, but it just seems crazy to doubt that humans evolved from other animals. So you're saying, well, that you think there's a possibility that humans not descend from other animals?
Well, what my argument is that you are making a categorical statement that evolutionary hypothesis is absolutely true. I am not contending that there's no evidence for it. And there are plenty of Christians who do, and you acknowledge this in your treatise, there are plenty of Christians who do hold to the evolutionary hypothesis. They're called theistic evolutionists, as you well know. And these are people who believe that God did it, but they can't settle the issue in their mind that all of this, what seems like design and creativity and the advancement of intelligence and so forth, is just the result of a bunch of random accidents, that something had to be guiding the process. The evolutionary hypothesis, though, is that everything is just a bunch of random accidents or chemistry happening, and the good outweighs the bad, the survival of the fittest, and so forth. I'm not arguing that there isn't evidence for evolution. I'm arguing that to say that it is categorically non-debatable is an overstatement. And that's what my friends and people that I associate with would concur with, that there are many of us that would tip our hats and say, yes, science has come a long way, baby, and we can't argue all points. But to assume then that because evolution has some merit scientifically, that there is no God, that there is no author of evolution or creation or whatever all of this comes from, again, is an overstatement and a little bit extreme for people to conclude that when they have no evidence for such a conclusion, that there is no cause of the evolutionary process or the creation process.
Okay, let's back up a little bit and let me sidestep the issue or the question about whether evolution could be God-guided or if it's 100% natural or not. Let's just say biological evolution, one definition of it might be that humans descended from other animals. I would say that is a fact. Now, would you say that is not a fact, that humans descended from other animals?
Well, I would say that I'm not comfortable with it as a human being. I see a clear distinction between me and other animals, and when you look at the fossil record, what you see is if there are human forms, hominids, and there certainly are those that exist, the people that would say that these are indeed human forms, they still look more like human beings than anything else. They might have variations of skull, but they tend to be human, more than anything else. So for me to say, well, that is a man evolving from some type of an ape-like creature, again, is a guess at best, and even scientists will acknowledge that much. They don't say categorically that we know exactly what this half-ape, half-person, or whatever it was, and what their life tendencies were. They say all of this is theory, speculation, and our best guess based upon what we can see in the record. So I'm not comfortable saying I can say for certain that I know that we evolved from other type of animal. I can say that there's a huge distinction between humans now and animals now, and if we evolved from them, it's a pretty impressive feat.
Well, I don't think the distinction is really relevant to anything. I mean, for example, you know, we came from other apes, and, you know, if you go back far enough, we came from fish. And, of course, there's a distinction between fish and humans, but what's that have to do with evolution?
Well, I mean, again, if you believe that evolution is categorically, undeniably true, then it has nothing to do with it. But if those of us who bring that into question and say there are other theories, there are other constructs, there are other ideas about how humankind got here, then of course we're going to bring into question, because obviously atheistic evolution is contrary to the faith that we hold. So we're not going to just, you know, wave a white flag and say, well, there you go, all the science says it's true, so therefore it is. And the reason for that is because atheism is so fatalistic. It offers no hope. Even in your own document, you say that when we're dead, that's it. We're no more valuable than a blade of grass. This is your own words. You said this. That we have our
no,
moment.
I didn't say valuable.
Well, I know, but you said we have our moment and then we die. Yes. It's like a blade of grass. Well, I think
like that, Jesus said that too, you know.
Yeah, well, but not quite that way, and you know it. The point is that we have value to life, and for us to assume that this is our only shot at it, and there's so much more to us in our emotional, spiritual, the love that we carry with us, all these things, to assume that that's just a chemical thing that fades away when we physically die, that is a hopeless, fatalistic philosophy that causes people to say, my conscience won't let me buy into the fatalism of biological evolution. So facts aside, whatever data you want to get from the scientific facts, it goes against human nature, and we want to say that there's value in human nature, as you want to say there's value in the DNA structure and the scientific structure. That's all fine and good, but it devalues the importance of the human person, and to say that we're nothing more valuable than anything that lives and dies, whether it be a blade of grass or a leaf or a goldfish. We want to think that we are the hallmark of God's creation.
Okay, I think your conversation is kind of mixing up maybe philosophy that is a consequence of evolution versus a science evolution.
It has.
But let me. Do we both agree? I think the highest value should be the truth, and we need to deal with the truth, whether it's happy or good or not.
But
or not.
But you don't know that you have the truth. That's my point.
Okay, but I mean, I think we do. I think we do.
Yeah, you say you do, and you say you think that you do, but that doesn't mean that you do.
Sure. Okay, so now, again, if I have the definition of biological evolution as just common descent, which means all the humans descended from other apes and, you know, et cetera, down to fish and everything, if I leave that as the as a definition of evolution, and you said there's good alternatives to that, really isn't the only alternative is just God created humans from a miracle, from scratch?
Well, that's obviously the traditional evangelical view. The young earth creationist view. I will concede that there are obviously millions of Christians who are not in that camp, who are not in the camp of instantaneous 6-day creation.
Well, also the old earthers, they also reject human evolution, so they also,
you know,
believe in special.
So, well, not all of them. They believe in different variations of it. That they do hold firmly to the idea of a special creation, that God viewed us as the hallmark, the apex of his creation. That's what his word says. And the reason we hold so dearly to it, again, philosophically, it's more comforting to us, because atheistic evolution is fatalistic. And human nature, something inside of human nature wants to live. We don't want to die. There's no joy in the thought of death. This is the reason we exercise, we eat right, we take nutritional supplements, we go to the doctor when we're sick. Life is important.
Yeah, I think that's just called the survival instinct. We were bred.
But survival in the here and now and in the afterlife, whatever it may be, the desire for life and eternal life is innate in human nature. That's why it's in every part of every religion, it's part of every culture on the face of the earth. And it always has been, and it always will be, because that is human nature.
Okay, so to back up again and to rephrase, if biological evolution was just common descent, that humans came from other animals, you know, forget about how, whether it was God-guided or not, or totally natural, But if biological evolution is just that humans came from other animals, another alternative is that God made humans from scratch by a miracle. Is there any other alternatives?
Well, not from my perspective. I mean, you know, I I'm not a Christian apologist and I'm not a Christian scientist, so I'm not in a position to debate the depth of that dialogue, except to say that those two are seem to be the only options. Either we evolved from something, or God put us here in the form that we are in now. I am most comfortable with the fact that God put us here in the form that we are now, because, again, it's not fatalistic. It seems to have purpose. It seems to value who I am. It seems to say God had a special place for me and all of humanity in his creation of us. So it feels better. It feels more natural. It's in line with my human nature. It's not contrary to who I see myself as, or who any human being sees himself as, something special in the eyes of God.
Okay, so I basically see as biological descent as a fact, and you don't. So I guess we'll leave it at that for now.
Okay,
we'll go on to the next one.
Yeah, it's not, well, what I say is it's not debate. It's not a non-debatable fact. Yeah, we can debate.
Okay.
We need to get onto the problem, don't we?
Yeah, but I mean, just in summary, I mean, I think the DNA evidence overwhelmingly both shows that evolution happened. You know, for example, for what they call pseudogenes is a strong argument for me. Uh-huh. And then also, if we were created separately, I think that would also be shown in the DNA. But instead, we see signs of descent again with the pseudogenes.
Well,
so to me, I think. So I mean, for me, I think we both see signs of descent plus the hypothesis that we are created uniquely. Right. Not from the animals, I think, is also shown, but...
Well, as Ronald Reagan said to Jimmy Carter, there you go again.
Yeah, right.
You said, you know, another one of your overstatements, I think the science overwhelmingly supports. Again, that is an overstatement. It's your opinion, but the science is certainly not overwhelmingly in that camp. It can be debated. There are plenty of people who would say the science that proves creationism is overwhelming. So... you don't get to have that one and say it's absolutely true. It's there you go again.
Okay. Well, we could talk about this much longer, just like the first one. So, but just to make it interesting, I think we'll move on to the next one.
There you go.
Okay, so this is the logical problem of evil. Now, again, we're talking about my booklet here. And what I said in here is that basically there's the two fields of science are enough to destroy Christian theology. That is biological evolution and neurology. But there are some Christians who fully accept modern science, and that I think, so for them, I would talk about philosophy and say, let's go further. And the problem of evil may be seen in two parts. One is moral evil, and the other one is natural evil. So for an example of moral evil, my Hitler killing 6 million Jews, and people say, you know, where is God in that? What was God doing? The other one for natural evil would be the things that nature does, like a killer tsunami in the 2004 Indian Ocean that killed hundreds of thousands of people and displaced millions of people. So what I was saying is, if you're an atheist, then this all makes perfectly sense. This is the way the natural world works. But if you believe in an all-good, all-powerful, all-knowing God, then there is no solution to this. And so your response...
But indeed there is. And it's not the end-all of the discussion to say... Because, first of all, there are three things I want to say to that, and I'm trying to be quick on these. Number one is that you have made God try to fit your standard, Truman's standard, that God should fix the problems of the world. God should not allow these things to happen. So, and since he doesn't, then he doesn't meet my standards, so therefore he can't exist or he can't be loving. Secondly, that God did create a perfect paradise, if the Genesis account is accurate, that the world was perfect, there was no pain, there was no evil, there were no tsunamis, there was no Hitler, the world was a perfect place, but because sin entered into the world, God allowed the result of sin to have its merit, and he turned nature over to its own merit, and everything went from perfection to chaos. And so what we see now is just any theologian, conservative, evangelical, conservative Christian would say to you that what is going on in the world today is a result of the fall, the result of the entrance of sin into the world. So, number one, you think that God doesn't meet your standard. Number two, you think that that it's just an irresolvable issue because God doesn't stop the tsunamis. But then number three, there's a third response, and that is that who's to say where God should stop on his correction of evil? Let's just say that there's a farm, a rancher in Arizona who's allergic to tumbleweed dust, and his whole life he sneezes every day, he constantly has a sinus headache. Well, you know, and he prays and says, God, you know, fix this, you know, and should God fix that? I mean, to him, that's evil. Not long ago, I paid $300 to have a fuel filter replaced on my car. I mean, it should have been nice if God would have just fixed that for me. You know, there are levels of problems, but here's the thing I want you to get, Truman, is this, that if God wiped out every evil in the world, every head cold, every form of cancer, every storm, then we wouldn't know what good is. We wouldn't know what good is. We wouldn't know what love is, because everything would be good all the time. So how can I know what love is if I don't know what evil is? If I don't have anything to compare it to. How do I know that I should serve if there isn't a reason to serve? The only reason we serve, my friend, is because someone has a need. They have a problem in their life. It's a bad thing. It could be considered an evil thing. But I serve because I'm trying to help them work through that evil. But if God fixed everything, there'd be no need for my desire for service. There'd be no need to help. So, yeah, there are some catastrophic issues. I mean, Category 5 tornadoes and hurricanes wiping out billions and billions of dollars of real estate. That's a bad thing. Every one of us would agree with that. Even Christians have to sit back and say, my God, where are you in this? But in the end, when it's all said and done, we can narrow that down to the ridiculous and say, well, if God's going to stop those kind of things, then he might as well fix my fuel pump while he's at it. He might as well fix my toenail fungus while he's at it, and my gingivitis and all these other things. And so if God is going to do that just for the big things that you consider are important, then why not take care of everything too? And it, but if he does, then we will never understand ever what bad is, and we certainly won't know what good is, and how can, because we won't have anything to compare it to. We will all be like Spock on the Starship Enterprise. Everything will just be logical, no emotion, because there is nothing to compare it to.
Okay, I'll address some of your comments there. First off, just a general comment is sometimes Christians say, like, well, what is evil? I mean, if you don't believe in God, you don't really believe in evil. And one thing I think is interesting, I didn't really appreciate Christopher Hitchens so much as an atheist spokesperson, but one thing he did say that I liked, and he had a definition of evil, which basically is like bad going off the rails. So in other words, it would be bad to mug somebody, but if you mug them and then you knife them 100 times and then shoot them 50 times and stomp on their body and their face and everything, that's evil, you know. So it's like going the extra mile and just being, you know. So anyway, that's how I'm kind of thinking of this problem of evil, is that, you know, I'm not talking about bad things like I have a backache. I'm talking about tremendous bad things like a tsunami that kills hundreds of thousands of people.
In other words, you want to give God the parameters of what's God or what's bad according to Truman. But to the guy down the street who has a sinus infection and it debilitates him from being able to go to work, to him that is an evil thing. To him that is a bad thing. To him that is bigger than life. So what you're doing is you're trying to categorize the levels of evil, and that's really not fair to the discussion. If God is going to wipe out evil, he needs to wipe out all of it. All of it. You can't just say, I as Truman Smith, get to define what evil is. Evil is evil depending on the context of the person living it.
But I think we can say some things are worse than others. For example, Hitler killing 6 million Jews was a lot worse than the tsunami killing.
But still, it's evil just the same.
Right.
It's still a bad thing. Okay. Toenail fungus is a bad thing to a lot of people.
If toenail fungus was the only problem, though, I don't think atheists would go around saying, like, look at this problem of evil. How do you explain this? You know.
Like I said, with all due candor, you're really stretching. And anybody that uses the problem of evil always have to define what they think evil is. And evil is always contextual, my friend. Your evil might not necessarily be my evil. My pain might not necessarily be yours. But you don't get to define it for me.
Well, actually, I mean, Well, the judicial system might do that. I mean, you can't just haul anybody in the court for anything. It's like, well, sorry, this is a crime, but you know, if you just call somebody a name, they'll say, hey, that's not bad enough to, you know, come in here.
Yeah, but we're talking about God, not the judicial system.
Yeah, but I mean, these are moral judgments about what's good and bad and justice and
right.
What's severe.
But all law-breaking is law-breaking. There's a fine for all of them.
No, there's no fine for calling somebody names, for example. I mean, like, if I cussed you out, okay. Or you cussed me out, I don't think we could get any
Well,
any
where we're
going
to part ways, Truman, is on the point of you want to define that there are levels of evil, and I'm going to say that evil is contextual. You know, I have a friend right now who I talk to on a regular basis who has vertigo, and to that particular lady, it is the plague of her life. At least
sure, sure,
season.
I understand.
And if God was going to stop the tsunami and going to make her more effective, then why not wipe that out too? I mean,
okay, so
pain
well,
and suffering is contextual.
Okay, so let me address your points real quickly here. The first
okay.
one I think you said is, why should God fix these? I think, and one of my comments is that you know, like if I saw somebody being mugged.
Mm-hmm.
You know, especially somebody I really love, like my daughter, you know, if somebody was being mugged and raped and stuff, I mean, I would stop that. I would do what I can. And supposedly God is supposed to be all loving and all powerful, so he would have like a zillion times more affection for this person who's being wronged, you know, brutally murdered and all that stuff than I would. So it's like, if I have enough decency to stop something, you know, why wouldn't God do that?
Well, I didn't say, you know, Your question was, you know, why wouldn't it? I didn't say that. I said, if God is going to, then why doesn't he stop all levels of evil? I didn't say, why doesn't God do it? You said that. I didn't. I said, if God is going to stop the tsunami or the rape, then why doesn't he stop the toenail fungus or the sinus infection or the vertigo? It's all contextual.
Okay, so let's look at Hitler, for example. It said that he killed 6 million Jews. Do you think God ever stopped in and did anything? Or was God saying, like, 6 million is okay, 10 million is too much, 2 million is not enough? Or did God sit out the whole thing?
You know, the Holocaust was horrible. Horrible. But so was the Black Plague that killed, what was it, two-thirds of Europe. I mean, and that's something that happened that no person like a Hitler offered. It was just an illness that they say was caused by rats or something like that. You know, it goes back to my first point that when the fall happened, God allowed a perfect system to become a chaotic system. Selfish people became even more selfish. And people like Hitler came along and Stalin and Mussolini, and these were horrible people in the history of the world. But it doesn't mean that God wasn't there. It doesn't mean that God, if in my perfect world, if I would say, God, why don't you do something? But again, I'm not God. His ways are not my ways. He didn't call me up and say, Tony, now before I allow the Holocaust, let me get your opinion on this. I think there's some things that he knows that you and I don't. Again, to wipe away the idea of God and eternal salvation in heaven, because of these evils that happened, and as horrific as they were, again, it's a stretch. Because
okay, so again with Hitler killing, let's say, 6 million Jews, do you think God ever did anything, or did he just say, hey, you know, let's just see what happens?
Well, I don't know what God did or didn't do. I wasn't born then. I believe that there are millions of Jews that survived it who will tell you that God saved them from the Holocaust. There are millions of them. Hundreds of thousands that were able to escape. There are many stories of salvation and victory before their families were murdered. There are stories of the miraculous there that if you would look at that rather than just the evil, but the victories that took place, I think you'll see that God did indeed intervene in some people's lives. But again, if people are going to be shot in the back of their head by a Nazi soldier, that's horrible. And you and I would agree with that. But I'm serving as a summer chaplain right now in a hospital setting. And just yesterday, I watched a 32-year-old woman eaten up with cancer, and she's going to die within the next 48 hours. Why doesn't he stop that, too? You know, that's not any less evil than a soldier shooting an innocent Jew in the back of the head. It's horrible. there are horrible things in this world and that God allows, but he allows them, my friend, simply because of the fall that took place in the garden. Now,
So you're saying that Hitler killing 6 million Jews is no difference than somebody having cancer?
Not to the person dying of cancer, it's not. It's a horrible.
What about to the independent observer who
the family member standing around that hospital bed that I was with just yesterday, and the tears streaming down their faces and the pain they were seeing for a 32-year-old. Believe me, it was just as horrible for them as Hitler killing a Jew.
How about an independent observer, somebody that doesn't know either family or doesn't know anybody who's being killed, but they see 6 million Jews and they see the other people dying of cancer?
These same people who are independent observers are going to see their own level of evil in their own life. They're either going to suffer from cancer themselves or they're going to know someone that's dying from it. None of us go through this life in a perfect utopia. And this is what atheists think that God ought to do. God ought to provide a perfect utopia. But what you don't get is that if God did provide that, then we would have no appreciation. God would not be God. He would just be our server. He would be the one that just provided for us a perfect world to live in. We would not understand what love, grace, and mercy is. We would just be logical beings like Spock running around because we wouldn't know what good and love is because there was nothing to compare it to.
Yeah, I don't think the atheist...
I can't know what good is unless I first of all know what bad is.
My position isn't that God should create a perfect world. My position is that there's a philosophical inconsistency with believing...
You're mad at God.
No, I think there's I'm just saying in theology there's an inconsistency with what people believe and what actually happens in the world. If people actually believe that God is all good, all powerful, all knowing, all everything positive, but yet what we see in life is... This doesn't add up with that. There's an internal inconsistency. But, you know, if you're an atheist, there's no inconsistency. What you see is what you get, and that's what you would expect.
Well, inconsistency, though, is both good and bad. Inconsistency is chaos, of course, because none of us see everything exactly the same. It's also good because it shows us our differences and our diversity and that we do see the world differently and how the world operates from a different perspective.
But when it comes to philosophical inconsistencies, I mean like this, it's not adding up with reality. For example, you could say, I believe in Santa Claus and he delivers presents all over the world, but you'd say, wait a minute, in real life that's physically impossible. So that'd be a philosophical inconsistency.
Well, of course it would be. It's also, but we also know that that's a non-truth. We know where that came from. We know where the idea of Santa Claus comes from. We can trace its history to its beginning points. So that it's a poor analogy because we always have known that it was a myth. To relate that to God is just frankly quite silly. We don't know all of our origins. We don't know where everything came from. We can only speculate based upon science and theology and philosophy. But none of us can dogmatically assert that I know this is true like you do in your document. Because you don't know. None of us in our humanness can quote infallibility.
Well, okay.
Or claim infallibility.
Now let me back up a little bit and talk about, this is called the problem of evil. Now, what I did in my booklet is I said, first off, there's two reasons in science. There's biological evolution and neurology, and that's enough to blow away theology. But yet there are some theologians who fully accept modern science. And so I'm saying to them, for them, let's go forward now and look at philosophy. So now when you look at philosophy, we have this problem of evil. And for example, you said, well, I think the fall explains a lot of things. But this fall is not an answer for these people who accept the modern science, because with evolution, that means there is no Adam and Eve. There was no first humans.
Right.
And so basically your main one of your main defenses is blown out of the water for anybody who fully accepts evolution. And so, for example, with people at the BioLogos, all these Christians who accept evolution fully, I have not seen any good answers from them at all. In fact, the biggest defense they usually give is the free will defense. And as I spoke in the book, the Bible even speaks against that. It's like, sorry, you can't use that defense because God, it says in there, God is a potter. He can make people for whatever he wants to.
Truman, I can play that same card with you. You don't have any good answers either. You have a theory. You have a speculation. You have what you think the evidence shows. And again, you've missed my point earlier. None of us who are honest are going to debate science and the results of science with you and scientists seriously. we're going to say that the evidence of science does suggest certain things, but it doesn't necessarily suggest what you think it does. But at the same time, there's another part of our humanity. We're not just rational thinkers in our intelligence. We're also philosophical. We're also spiritual. We're also hopeful for something beyond this life. And atheistic biological evolution offers no hope. So therefore, it is innate within human nature to reject it, regardless of the evidence. And that's not dishonest. That's not them saying, well, the evidence isn't true. It's them trying to grapple with their spiritual aspect of who they are, their ability to reason, and their honest intellect with the science. So what I'm talking to you about is a wholeness of both all aspects of my personality and my being, my spiritual, my emotional, my intellectual, my philosophical. All you're talking about is rational. And to you, everything is just rational. But to those billions of people out on the face of the earth who practice some form of religion, to them it's not about rational. Everything isn't rational. Everything is about, can be rational and intelligent, but it's also emotional and spiritual and hope beyond this life and something that says there's love behind the evil of the world, there's a purpose to it, that everything happens for a reason, that something is far beyond our control, and we hope that this life isn't all there is. And we look at the evidence and we see signs of that. We can see stories of the miraculous and so forth. We can hear testimonies of people that have been ultimately blessed by what they consider to be the acts of God. I can tell you my own story. Let me
do some more of my responses here, though. First, I want to try to have some equal time.
Okay.
Equal time on this.
I think I've been pretty fair.
Okay. Well. Again, for the people who perfectly accept modern science, and I'd refer to somebody like Francis Collins, who wrote The Language of God. He's an evangelical Christian, and he says, you know, evolution is a fact, and let me show you why in my book. I don't think they have an answer for this problem of evil. And, for example, the answer you gave about Adam and Eve in the fall, they would not give that because they don't believe in Adam and Eve. They think it's a myth. It wasn't not a literal, you know, creation story. So that's my only... point that I wanted to give to you about the fall is, like, sure, you know, if you're a young Earth creationist or an old Earth creationist, you can blame things on the fall. But I would say if you accept modern science, then you have to see the fall as a figurative thing, and it never happened. So that's not an answer to bring forward.
Well, okay, but again, for you to say that doesn't, to use your words, wipe it away. It's just your opinion, based upon what you read and what you think is rational truth. Now, there are different interpretations of the fall and different understandings of it, but the bottom line is that you and I will agree on this. There are bad things in the world. You and I just disagree on where those bad things come from, where evil comes from. You know, I believe it's a result of mankind being wicked and rebellious against the purpose of God. You believe it's just innate in human nature to kill each other.
Well, wait a second. So if there's the Indian 2004 Indian Ocean tsunami that killed hundreds of thousands of people and displaced millions, do you think that came from the fall, or is that just tectonic plates? You know,
I think it came from tectonic plates, but God allowed the tectonic plates to shift and cause massive tsunamis and earthquakes and horrible things as a result of Him turning over a perfect creation to a chaotic creation that was the choice of man by being rebellious against the plan of God.
So do you think before the fall of Adam and Eve there was no earthquakes?
I do. But it didn't take long.
Well, no,
the fall to happen. I do.
Okay,
I think it's absolutely perfect.
Well, here's another thing, too, that, you know, supposedly when God created Adam and Eve and said, you know, everything is good, there are some people, too, who say, well, you know, Adam and Eve, because of their sin, they ushered in death into the world. But there's a counterpoint that you need to have death, because if you don't have death, the world would not be sustainable. We'd have people walking over each other. I mean, there'd be no room to even walk one step.
I agree.
So in order to be sustainable, you would have to have death. That means if creation is good, it would have to be sustainable, which means you have death. And so it wouldn't make sense to say creation is good without death.
No, you don't have any argument with me on that. But but as far as how far
but you
population
think, but you
goes.
think death didn't come in. But you would say that death didn't come in until the fall of Adam and Eve. So if Adam and Eve didn't sin, that would have been better, maybe, right?
Well, like I said, I don't know what God's plan was beyond it. Say, as the fall did not happen, there might have been a time when he said, "Okay, there's enough people and there's enough of this human world. We're just going to go on into an eternal place anyway, and that'll be the end of it." I don't know. I can't address that because I have no definite answer on that. Still doesn't minimize the point that I'm trying to make, and which the point that I'm trying to make is as all of the evidence that you have in your corner, and I have conceded that there are many points of science that we cannot contest, that we have to deal with, it does not therefore mean, though, that God is not there and that he didn't author some of it or even all of it. It does not mean that there is no God because science points in a certain direction. That's just a huge leap on the part of those who are atheists, and it's also extremely fatalistic. And it is against human nature that has the desire for significance and purpose. Atheism offers no purpose outside of daily existence.
Yeah, I don't really want to get into the purpose. It's not that I'm just involved only in the rational part. It's more like I think we have to take this into two steps. The first step is what is truth? And first, let's define what the truth is. And then number two, how do we deal with it? And whether something's fatalistic or not is part of number two, how you deal with it. And I don't really want to talk about that just because I don't think we have time for it. So I think the first part is just trying to determine what is true. For example, evolution, or do we have a soul and that kind of stuff. But let me say one more thing about this problem of evil. There's the Bible verse, I think it's Colossians, I can't remember, but it says that basically God holds everything together. And that's another whole complication to this, is that when there's a tsunami that kills 100,000 of people, that tsunami would not be possible without God holding it together in that circumstance. So does God hold only the good things together, or does God hold everything together? The Bible says everything, which would make him, this mass murderer killer guy.
Well, I don't know how many of our listeners understand the word exegesis, but you do as a seminarian. And that's poor exegesis on your part, and I think you know it. The holding together doesn't mean isolated things here and there. It means he holds the entire purpose of his creation together, that in spite of the good and the bad, in spite of the evil, the cancer, the tsunamis, the tornadoes, the hurricanes, in spite of the toenail fungus or whatever else, everything God holds together for the ultimate revelation of his purpose, which is, in Colossians, the magnification and the glory of his Son, the Lord Jesus. That's what Colossians is about. It's the entire book is a treatise of the majesty of who Jesus is, and so he is holding everything together so that as many will have the opportunity to come to know Christ will, and will understand him in his glory one day. So your exegesis is sadly weak, and I'm sorry for that because you're a graduate of our school.
No, but I think we agreed completely, because what I said was that according to that Bible verse, when there's that 2004 tsunami that killed hundreds of thousands of people, that was only made possible.
Let me rephrase it. You're just rephrasing the question. I'm going to say the same thing again. Your exegesis of Colossians 1 is very poor. You don't understand the context of the purpose of Colossians.
Okay, just allow me to just 10 seconds.
Go ahead.
That is, that earthquake, that tsunami would not have happened unless Jesus held it together. So Jesus held that tsunami together, and that's why it killed hundreds of thousands of people. If it wasn't for Jesus...
Just for the sake of our listeners, I'm just going to tell them to rewind this and listen to what I said before, because I'm just going to say what I said before. Your exegesis and understanding of the Colossians is incredibly weak, and that's all I can say. If a New Testament professor was sitting here instead of me, he would be much harsher with you than I am.
Well, okay. Well, I was hoping to have some dialogue over it, but okay.
You can dialogue all the way, but your premise is flawed. And if your premise is flawed, then the rest of your argument is weak as well.
But I think we have an agreement, though, that Jesus holds it all together.
Agreed. But he holds it together for a purpose grander than holding off tsunamis.
Okay, but it sounds like we agree on the premise, though.
No, according to the Bible verse. No, because what we disagree on is what he holds together. you're saying.
But we both agree.
You're saying that if he holds everything together, there won't be any bad. There won't be any tsunamis. There won't be earthquakes. I'm saying he holds things together in spite of the fact that there are tsunamis and earthquakes. That his purpose of the revelation of his son Jesus is why everything is held together by God, in spite of the evils of the world.
Okay, well, we have a disagreement there over.
Of course we do.
Some things. Okay, let me see if we have any comments here. Since this is a trial run, I think there might be comments. So let me see if I can load this up. It'll take just a minute. Do you want to talk more about your book or anything while we're waiting?
It's a book on preaching. It's just, if you're interested in expository preaching, it's a textbook that I wrote for my students, because the teaching method that I teach is called the Homiletical Bridge, and my students kept asking me, it would be really great if you put this in book form rather than just lectures. So it's just a in-print explanation of the approach to expository preaching that I teach. So it would be beneficial to those who are interested in expository Bible teaching or expository Bible preaching.
Okay. Well, it looks like we don't have any comments here.
It's probably a good thing.
Okay. said we had two or three viewers while it was going live. But okay, do you have any closing comments you want to give? And then we'll sign off with that.
Outside of the fact that I've enjoyed it, I appreciate it. I think it's been fairly balanced as far as the time is concerned. I appreciate the respect that you've shown to me, and I hope I've conveyed that back to you. Consider us friends, even though we disagree on these very important matters. And I admire the fact that you're at least doing something about what you believe, even though I might not agree with the result of it. And I wish you well in all that you do.
Well, thank you, because I feel the same way. I deeply appreciate that you say, you feel like we could be friends. That's one thing I would like. I'd like to kind of show that people could talk about these things. And a lot of people, they won't even talk to an atheist, or an atheist won't talk to a Christian, vice versa, So that's one reason why I try to do this, to help people, show people that we could talk about things. So.
Yeah, that's unfortunate.
Even though we have a wide chasm of different things we believe in, it seems like we need to have a lot more talks. But I hopefully it's a start. Instead of in society, it's safer just to say don't talk about it, right?
That's true.
So
if you avoid it, it isn't there.
Yeah. Okay. So we'll close our eyes and all disappear now.
Truman, it's been a lot of fun. I really appreciate it.
All right. Thanks for being there, and we'll sign off.